Unfortunately, nobody knows the exact number because the government keeps all of this behind closed doors and doesn't release any information to the families of most of the people who are taken. But according to the Syrian Network of Human Rights, they have counted, not estimated, but counted 128,000 people who have been reported by their families or by witnesses to be taken by the security forces and not emerged from the prisons. That 81,000 of those people, their families have not had any word from them whatsoever. So this is a sprawling system. Human rights groups estimate that the total number of Syrians who have passed through it could be in the hundreds of thousands.
The New York Times exposé begins with the story of Mohammed Ghabash. His testimony, echoed by many other survivors, revealed that by 2012, quote, there was an industrial-scale transportation system among prisons. Detainees were tortured on each leg of their journeys in helicopters, buses, cargo planes. Some are called riding for hours in trucks normally used for animal carcasses, hanging by one arm, chained to meat hooks. Mr. Ghabash's new cell was typical, 12 feet long, 9 feet wide, usually packed so tightly prisoners had to sleep in shifts. Tell us Mohammed's story, how you met him, how you learned of the situation, and then why you say you think actually the uprising in 2011 was caused by this kind of sadistic, torturous prison system.
Mohammed Ghabash was very typical of the types of people that were sucked into this system. He was a protester and eventually led peaceful protests in Aleppo when the uprising began in 2011. And he was arrested the first time in 2011, was arrested several times that year and in 2012, and was taken to a number of different facilities. He said he was like a tour guide to torture. And he was forced to, as you said, act the roles of animals. He was—
This is in kind of pseudo-plays for officers.
Yes.
And guards at dinner.
Yeah, kind of entertainment. But also much more, I shudder to call it routine, but the more routine types of torture, being hung by wrists, being put into stress positions and beaten, until he made a false confession, which was something that happened to most of the prisoners. Look, I think the use of this system followed a playbook that Assad's father began in Hama in 1982 when there was an uprising, and it— The idea was to suck up the people who were nonviolent protesters because it's easier to go after the ones that are violent. Of course, there were all kinds of people arrested, but there was special focus on arresting civilian protesters because those are the biggest threat at the end of the day. We're talking about a state with all the machinery of state power and violence at its disposal. It's, in a way, easier for them to fight the people that pick up arms, and it's harder for them to face people that are using civil methods. In a way, this is something that everyone knew in Syria, in the sense that it's not a new system. It's been around for a long time. But what we decided to do over the years, and of course we did this while covering the daily news of Syria over the years, was to try to go deeper, to try to get accounts of survivors who corroborated one another and were corroborated by documents. It took a very long time to get enough people who had their families safely out of Syria and felt safe to talk and to get documents and to basically, you know, over the years, many human rights organizations and journalists and lawyers worked on this issue. So we're talking about evidence that has accreted over the years and adds up to this big picture. Now, one of the toughest parts is speaking to the survivors about what they've been through. And we spoke to dozens of them, me and my wonderful team of Syrian and Lebanese colleagues. Now, you need to be sensitive when you're dealing with victims of trauma and without sacrificing journalistic rigor, without sacrificing verification. But this was a long process. This had a huge emotional impact on us, as well as, of course, on the survivors who had to retell their stories. So, you know, it took time, it took energy, and it does sort of make you ask yourselves a lot of questions about humanity and how this kind of thing can continue to happen in the 21st century.